are listening to an American Free Press podcast.
Joining me on the line is Dr. Michael Turner, an associate professor of criminal justice and criminology at the University of North Carolina in Charlotte. Dr. Turner, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Dr. Turner, I just recently saw an article in USA Today. Study: nearly one in three will be arrested by age 23. Now, I want to get into that in a minute, but before we do, for the benefit of the listeners, could you tell them, who is Professor Dr. Michael Turner?
I am associate professor in the Department of Criminal Justice and Criminology at the University of North Carolina at Charlotte, as you had mentioned. I obtained my degree at the University of Cincinnati, my PhD and master's at the University of Cincinnati. I do work in delinquency and understanding criminal behavior as it evolves over the life course.
And you were one of the authors of this study, right?
That is correct.
There were three colleges, three universities, three schools involved in the study?
That's correct. Robert Brain, who is a colleague of mine, is the lead author on the article. He is a professor here at the University of North Carolina at Charlotte. And then Ray Paternoster is a professor at the University of Maryland. And Sean Bushway is a associate professor at the University at Albany.
This study was published in the journal Pediatrics. And the article in USA Today, I just want to read a couple of parts from it real quick. The data was collected between 97 and 08 by the Bureau of Labor Statistics. And they were annual surveys conducted over those 11 years, and they asked children, teens, and young adults between the ages of 8 and 23 whether they had ever been arrested by police or taken into custody for illegal or delinquent offenses. The question excluded only minor traffic offenses. What happened was that, I guess, because of this study that was published, as it says in this article, 44 years ago by a criminologist that found that 22% of youth would be arrested by age 23. And this study came out, and at least in the USA Today article, it says the latest study finds 30.2% of young people will be arrested by age 23. But in the abstract that's on the Pediatrics website, it says between 30.2 and 41.4%. So is it actually, so it's actually higher than 30.2 that was listed in USA Today.
This is an example of individuals who are self-reporting their activities.
Right.
And inevitably, you're going to have people who fall out of the sample, who don't respond. So we refer to them as missing data. Okay. We don't know what their offending activities are like. So the 30.2 estimate reflects an estimate that assumes that the individuals who are missing were at least as likely to be arrested as those who reported, which is a relatively conservative estimate because realistically, we know from past studies that individuals who fall out of samples and stop reporting are probably a little bit more likely to be higher risk individuals. So realistically, the 30.2% may actually be an underestimate of the true amount of arrests that there are in society. So I think we'd probably be comfortable saying that it's somewhere in the mid-30s is the true estimate. So the range into the 40s indicates what would happen if all of those folks who were missing actually were arrested. And that's probably an unreasonable assumption as well. We know that probably not everybody who falls out of a sample has actually been arrested. So I would say that the true estimate falls somewhere above the 30.2, and I would say somewhere in the low to mid-30s is the true estimate.
For purposes of aesthetics, it's 33 and a third. So one-third of that segment of the population is actually being arrested. What's going on?
As we talk about in the piece, it could reflect a number of things. Part of it could be that we're just getting tougher on certain types of crimes. When you look back in the 1960s compared to now, I think law enforcement is probably a little bit more aggressive on drug-related activities, violence-related activities. So we might be a little bit more aggressive towards those things, which probably elevates the true arrest rates for those individuals. There's also, you know, if you look about what's going on in schools with more of the zero-tolerance policies and things of those sorts. So there might be an issue with schools becoming a little bit more aggressive and intolerant of individuals when they engage in these activities. So whereas a fight years ago may have been broken up in the school and kids may be suspended or sent on their way, now they're being referred to the police and might be getting arrested. So there might be a little of that going on. But both of those are empirical questions that the data or future researchers should take a hard look at.
Right. There's a lot of factors obviously at play here. So
sure. That's correct.
Now, between the ages of, what was that, 8 and 23?
That's correct.
Did you happen to find what was the most popular age for being arrested?
In the study, we provide an estimate per year, so it allows us to show the growth of the arrest rate. And similar to the Christensen data, and Christensen is the criminologist you referred to earlier, back in 1965, who did his estimates, the greatest growth in arrest rates occurs during the adolescent period, and probably the later adolescent period. When I say later, probably between 15 and 18 in that area. We show a nice graph in the piece that the Christensen data shows that the prevalence rates start to drop or at least flatten out when individuals reach the age of adulthood, and we'll say that's 18, which suggests that the rate of growth in arrests after the age of 18 is not as high as it was in adolescence. Whereas in the present data that we work with, that growth continues beyond the age of 18. And as a matter of fact, if you look at the piece, that we really don't see much of a flattening out of the growth, even up to the age of 23. So what that's suggesting is that individuals are still earning their first arrest well after the age of 18. Because once an individual gets arrested, they count as an arrest. So after the age of 18, it's only those individuals who are getting arrested for the very first time. So we see that we still have a lot of growth beyond the age of 18, whereas in the Christensen data, you really don't see that growth as much.
Were you or your colleagues surprised by the results?
A man by the name of Jeffrey Arnett has coined the term emerging adulthood. And emerging adulthood is that period in that kind of overlaps beyond adolescence, but not quite adulthood. And if you look at the age at which individuals get married, the age at which they first start giving birth to children, the age at which they get their first job or the job after school and things of those sorts, those are occurring later and later in life. And what we are suspecting is that because those are occurring later in life, that individuals are free, I guess, to engage in more risky activities for a longer period of time, hence the growth in the arrest rates beyond the age of 18. So whereas years ago, getting married, having children tends to settle you down and get you out of those risky lifestyles, because people have naturally moved that age back, they actually are free to still engage in risky activities, which ultimately and unfortunately oftentimes end up with an arrest.
Right. So they delay marriage. That means they're in the market for more criminal activities longer.
That's correct.
Right. Now, you got your data, I guess, from, was it just one study, the National Longitudinal Survey of Youth 1997?
That's correct.
How do those guys
That's
do
correct.
It? That's part of the Bureau of Labor Statistics, I guess, right?
That is correct. It's a national probability sample of several thousand individuals that they interview on a year-to-year basis. In 1997, when the initial study started, I believe they're between the age of 12 and 16. So fast forward, they're now in their late 20s, actually probably in their early 30s. They've now released more data beyond what we have. We actually ran these analyses a year and a half ago or a year ago. What's nice about this is that since the National Longitudinal Survey of Youth 97 version, because there are several other versions as well, since it's continuing on, it allows us to monitor this trend and will allow us to follow these individuals up into their 30s or 40s or however long they follow these individuals. So what we can do is extend this in the future to see what happens at the age of 30 and 35 and 40 to see how that pans out over time and see if we see that flattening out that Christensen saw at an earlier period.
Right. How do they enlist these people into these studies? Would you happen to know that?
I'm not part of the data collection team at all. Actually, I had a student once who was part of this, who was actually a respondent in the survey. And I can't recall if he received an incentive, a monetary incentive each year. And if they do, it's relatively small in the area of like $25 or $50 to be a part of the study. But generally, larger studies like that, you might see an incentive for individuals to stay involved in the study only because it's very difficult, not only to survey individuals once, but to survey them multiple times. But the sampling scheme on this study, I mean, it's a multi-level sampling scheme where they're eventually identifying households and then individuals within the household. So there's various levels of that. And as I said, I'm not a part of that data collection team, so I don't know the guts of that, how they do that in a specific fashion off the top of my head.
How many people were in this survey?
In the sample that we use, it was 7,335.
So you can actually grab different numbers of people that you want to sample.
They oversample for a couple of groups. They oversample for African-Americans, Hispanics, and economically disadvantaged white individuals. I'm quite certain of that. I'm pretty sure of that. So what we did, not to get too methodological, but we excluded that. It's a relatively small portion of the sample. We excluded those individuals because we wanted to make the sample a nationally representative sample. So we only used the cross-sectional sample. And we say that in the paper. So there's a small portion of individuals who were excluded only because it kind of violated the assumptions of what we were trying to do, and the assumptions were that we were trying to make this as nationally representative as possible. Once you move away from that and start using the oversample, then you have to start dealing with sampling weights and things that are much more complex to deal with. So we excluded those individuals a small amount and then only dealt with the people who were in the cross-sectional sample.
Right. I guess if someone wanted to make a point, they could actually include that sample that you excluded, and I guess it would skew the result or it could skew the result in a different direction than you came up with, right?
If they use that sample, it could come up with slightly different results. But you know, every study, when you write it up, you make clear the decisions that you made along the way. And we share the data here in terms of the summary data. And you know, we make available, if people want, all the code that we used and the data that we used. So if people wanted to replicate this, they're welcome to that data.
Okay. And I wasn't able to get the study, actually, because when you click on full text PDF,
they want you to pay for it.
Yeah. How many pages was it?
It's an 8 or 9 page study. Pediatrics limits you on how much you can write. Every study in pediatrics is about the same length. Every journal has different writing stipulations in terms of the length of the article. And pediatrics is known for their brevity. They really limit you kind of the literature review and things of those sorts. I believe their limit is like 3,000 or 4,000 words that you can write. So it's really kind of short.
And of course, pediatrics is the official journal of the American Academy of Pediatrics. Besides the fact that people are postponing marriage, and that police are, well, obviously anybody with an internet connection can see that, the police are acting more aggressively in a lot of ways than they had in the past. Are there any other major reasons that you think affected the study? And do you think that it's going to actually go higher and higher as time goes on?
Well, it can't get lower, because once you're arrested, you're always going to be a part of the population that's been arrested. So at best, it will flatten out, and that would imply that nobody else is being arrested. But from other data, we know that individuals still get arrested later in life. The individual driving home from a party gets a DUI, or pick your poison as to why people get arrested. So inevitably, that curve will always be somewhat increasing, but we should expect to see a flattening out as individuals age. So only because people, again, become more settled down and things tend to ground you a little bit more, and you just don't have an inclination to get involved in the risky activities that you did when you're experiencing the adolescent period of development.
Most of us have been there, right?
I have 2 kids and I'm married, and you know, I look back at when I was in college and where I am now, and I see that my life is different. And there's a lot of research that suggests that marriage and employment and having children are all kind of insulating factors or protective effects, where they tend to settle people down and kind of get you out of that life of risky activities.
Right. You said earlier that data is still being sent out of this study, and you are constantly crunching the numbers, I guess, and that this study was actually started, what did you say, a year and a half ago? Was that right? Or a year ago?
Yes, we actually started probably about a year and a half ago we started doing it. By the time it goes through the review process and revisions and things of those sorts, and then once it gets accepted, I think it was accepted back in September, then there's a time for it to come out and print and stuff. So in any study that's done, it's usually probably a year or two old in terms of when the researchers actually analyze the data. So fortunately, that's part of the scientific process, that it takes time for study results to get into print. We are constantly thinking about how this unfolds, and there's a lot of different directions you can go with this. When you think about an arrest and what an arrest means, most job applications, and this is particularly important now given the state of the economy, they ask either, have you ever been arrested, or have you ever been convicted, or both. Now that by the age of 23, one-third of the population is having to check that box with, have you ever been arrested? And when you think about that, when jobs are tight and the competition for jobs is relatively fierce, you got a group of individuals who are now perhaps, you know, I can think of myself as an employer, and I'm looking for reasons to cut people out in terms of interviewing them or why I wouldn't hire them. You got to think that an arrest is probably one of those things that will dwindle down your population of individuals for which you're interested in hiring. So as that number grows, you got to think about how that'll affect prospects or career opportunities and things of those sorts. You know, I work in criminal justice, and I don't think any of the federal law enforcement agencies or state law enforcement agencies or local law enforcement agencies really want to hire people with arrests on their records. I don't know the agencies well enough to state whether that does cancel them out, but I think that does impact your prospects. So you got to think about how an arrest will affect your social capital as you move forward in terms of trying to get a job. Again, look at it from a marriage standpoint. When you have to admit to your future spouse that you've been arrested for transgressions, whatever they may be, that may impact the pool of individuals who perhaps may be interested in you. So there's a variety of different things that you can think that, what are the effects of being arrested? So we're thinking about that. We're also thinking about what might be related to this, what might be causing this, or what other precursors might be adding to an arrest. Now, we were talking the other day about suspensions in school. and the issue of being suspended in school. And typically that occurs because individuals are not following the rules in the school. They're violating some type of conduct policy there, and they're suspended. Well, that's basically an arrest at the school level. There's a debate as to whether a suspension is good or bad for students. And you think about students who are suspended, it allows them having more freedom to get in more trouble. So there's a group of individuals that think that it might not be good to suspend individuals. And there's a group of individuals that believe they shouldn't be in school because they're affecting the educational environment of people who want to learn. So you might want to exclude those individuals from school so they don't disrupt the individuals or impact the individuals who are there to learn. So, you know, when you think about a suspension, the types of effects suspensions have over the life course and how they may impact, and how they actually might be related to arrests. Because, again, extending that logic, if a suspension is pretty much just a result of a punishment for violating school policy in some way, shape, or form, then that perhaps probably increases your probability to be arrested. If you're not following rules in school, it's likely that you're not following rules in society. So you got to think about how those two might be related. And folks can look at those. It might have a lot of implications as to how we deal with individuals in schools in terms of whether we suspend those individuals or not. So long answer to your question, I mean, there's really a variety of different ways you can go with understanding the impact of things that might be contributing to arrest or the outcomes of what might happen after an arrest. So that's kind of the things that we're talking about and exploring.
Like I said, it touches on so many areas. It seems like it's all-encompassing. I'm reading on your website here, and it seems like you, I don't know, maybe I'm wrong, but pay attention more to the psychology of criminality. Would I be right in saying that?
I don't know about psychology. I probably consider myself more of a generalist. You know, I don't want to pigeonhole myself in any one specific area of work, whether it be psychology or sociology or biology. But I guess I'm probably more interested in just how offending and delinquency and victimization kind of unfolds over the life course and impacts people's lives and things of those sorts. So, you know, you look at the criminological research, of course, that biology and heredity and things of those sorts are having a long-lasting influence of sociology and psychology. I wouldn't pigeonhole myself in any one specific area.
Gotcha. But, for example, I guess some of your colleagues who might study, for example, police brutality.
Correct.
That's something, I guess, that really is kind of straightforward. I mean, you have videos. Do you know colleagues like that?
I do. You know, I don't know about anybody here at our university who does brutality. I know some colleagues who do use of force, which is probably the nice way to say brutality.
Right.
I'm not a policing researcher, but use of force is really a continuum where there's everything from the highest of lethal use of force to other less stringent types where you're just talking about physical force, verbal reprimand and stuff. So there is a big literature. I don't know that literature. I don't work in that area, but there are a lot of folks around the country who do that sort of work.
Yeah, I was going to ask you anything about the trend.
About use of force trends?
Yeah.
Yes. I do not know that. I've talked to some of my policing friends or colleagues, but I don't know if we know of any trends of brutality or use of force. And I say that because when I have talked to my students, you know, and I just use the example of, is violence going up or down? And inevitably, everybody thinks it's going up. Everybody. Everybody says we are becoming a much more violent society. And you look at arrest statistics, and violence has been going down. Actually, the same day that the release of the study came out, the FBI released their uniform crime reports and their update on the first half of 2011, and basically documenting a decrease in violence. I forget what the percent was, but you got this subset of the population who believe that violence is probably at all-time highs, and realistically, we're at relatively low levels of violence now. So that speaks to, and you relate it back, is the impact that the media has and the inundation that we hear that when somebody's violent or particularly heinous violent offense, the media saturates that, and we have all these 24-hour news stations and things of those sorts where you're always getting inundated with this idea that we're a violent culture. I'm not saying we're not. It's just that the media tends to kind of skew our views about how violent we really are. So getting back to your brutality, because I don't know if brutality is going up or down. And frankly, I don't know if people collect that on a longitudinal basis where we monitor that year to year.
Right. I guess maybe because so many people are behind bars, maybe that's one of the reasons you don't want violent people out on the streets. But isn't the U.S. the number one in the world as far as incarceration rates?
We are. We're the highest incarceration rate. And it's been going up for decades.
Yeah, we're over, what, 2 million people are in prison, I think, something like that.
I believe it's somewhere around 2.3 or 2.4 million in prison, somewhere in that area, if I'm not mistaken.
Right, and growing. Dr. Michael Turner, Associate Professor of Criminal Justice and Criminology at University of North Carolina, Charlotte, I want to thank you so much for the time you took out of your day explaining all this to the listeners, and looking forward to looking at future studies.
Well, I appreciate your time, and thanks for taking interest in our study. We appreciate it.